The best reason in the world.
The best reason on the net. Well,
we better start. We've got a lot of great people in here excited to hear you talk.
Hey, it's early for me, so.
We'll promise to make sure we put all those jabs of Gator in here, too.
Oh, so, yeah. He's hanging out in chat, so.
I can't complain now. What the hell? Nope,
there, we there we go. Hello, everyone, and thanks for tuning in to episode 146 of the Guardian Hub podcast, where we talk Destiny, interview guests, and talk about our love of the game. Your hosts, as always, are Kingsley, Mac, DesRaven, and Cyn. How is everyone doing tonight?
Hey, magical, as always.
And?
Oh.
Well, that can be an and for Cyn, too.
No, this but just like, long deliberate pause. Update, my ankle feels better. Still a little stiff and sore, but the swelling has gone down, so huzzah.
See, that's more interesting than just since
magical.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, I mean I don't really have an update. I mean it's status quo.
You have an update. Quo. You were saying your work is crazy as shit right now.
Hey. Did we say we were going to curb that language? I'm kidding. Yes. We were talking a little bit the other day off podcast. I think we were doing something. Might have been a raid or another activity or shenanigans. And they got a requirement now. Like it used to be 40, 50 calls a day, which may have been a little bit too much in the kind of role that we're in, especially when you're trying to balance loan management and you know actually being an account executive for your client. They recently, like 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago, they said, we're going to try to push for 75. And then they put some pressure on some of us new people and said, now you got to be 100. And I'm just getting like between 50 and 60 a day is kind of like where I start tapping out. But I also take more pride in making sure like the system's up to date, making sure the information's in there. Like I'm reviewing notes from other like executives, like they're just flying through calls. They don't even know if the number's right. If they don't get an answer, they just log the call and move on with life. I'm actually making sure I have the correct contact information, making sure I'm getting to the person who's going to make the decision. Like I'm actually doing what I should be doing. And in turn, I only get 50 to 60 calls in and I'm still working till 6-7 o'clock at night to do that.
Wow. That's the most you've talked in a while.
Yeah, right.
I see. I get passionate about it.
Yeah, it's amateur BS, as Hazel likes to put it.
Yeah. Okay. Real quick, before we get to our guest, we do have a guest tonight. I just got to test this out because live update for me. Okay, you know we all have this lovely one.
I can't complain now. What the hell,
Cyn? You can't complain about your life. Your life is fine.
I know, right? I have a job at least right now.
But let's see.
I'll trade with you.
Yeah, Des will trade. And I'll trade with you. Live update sound here.
What am I going to do with a Titan? They're damn near useless.
Yes, and your Titan's useless.
Haters.
Thanks for the people giving me live sound clips in the middle of the show.
That's awesome. And how does this segue into our guest, Kingsley?
Well, it segues great into our guest because we can play it like this. We have a guest that was on another podcast that we know that we won't name. No, I'm just kidding. Guardian Downcast. He was a great guest on there, but he will be an even better guest on our show, I'm sure. Ha ha ha. We have Mr. 8FOO. How you doing, man?
I'm doing good, and I don't know if I'll be a better guest, but I will definitely be a more sober guest.
Will you? Or will...
Amateur bullshit.
See, they had the unfortunate circumstance to catch me on vacation when I didn't have to work the next day.
Now screw that. I mean... Crack it open. Start checking. No.
Well, you don't have to be like all suit and tie on our show, so go ahead and let it loose, too.
Oh, that's fine. I did pregame a little bit. Always have to have a little social lubricant before I get on these things. You'd think after doing this enough times, I'd be comfortable speaking to a mic in front of an audience. And you know what? Nah, it still hasn't gotten to that point.
Right.
I still get that the pregame jitters. Like, I don't get it. I don't know if they'll ever go away.
You know how probably they not used to say picture people in their underwear and it just kind of makes like the jitters go away?
Yeah, no, that made me drink more.
I mean, at least with podcasting, people are actually in their underwear, and you don't have
I
to
might be
it
right now.
I was about to say I can confirm such a thing. But...
Yeah, so picture all of us in our underwear or not.
All right, I'm going to need another drink.
Yeah. Take a sip. I'm taking a sip right now.
Yeah, I actually just finished my beer, so let me grab one real quick.
Now you can move on to something harder.
Oh, no, 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 right. No.
No.
give me 20 seconds, so I'll be right back.
All right. Oh, man. Well, I do want to give thanks to Des for recommending this guest, because I know it's been on our, I was going to say short list, but long list. We've had the idea for a while, but
okay, the
scheduling worked out.
All right. And this is podcasting history. This is the first guest I booked myself.
Oh, like, really?
Entirely. Yeah.
I am so sorry.
Right?
You set a precedence.
The nightmare to book this guy, let me tell you, it was an adventure.
Oh, and you caught me in a sweet spot. I'm actually going back to graveyards the end of next week. Oh, yep.
Ooh, that is happening. Ew.
Yep.
Ooh. Ooh. So what do you
yeah, that... not envy that?
Yeah, when Des reached out to me to begin with, he's like, do you have any time coming up? I'm like, I'm working 9 to 5 in the morning. I'm like, and he goes, well, maybe we could move the podcast around, but I'm like, not, I mean, you guys have your weekends. So, we tried to work it around, when I switched off of it, which was beginning of December, but that was unsure. And I'm like, I can't confirm or deny, but I know I have, some time coming up, between Christmas and New Year's. And then Gator and Hazel poached me.
Mm-hmm. Bastard.
Yeah. I think I said to Des, I'm like, some other cast may have already booked me for that Thursday.
Cast, of course.
At least they were down.
Mm-hmm. Best down on the net.
The best down on the net. The best down cast. The best cast that's down. I don't know.
So yeah, no, it worked out beautifully that you guys picked this week.
Yeah, and do you do anything interesting for work that you want to talk about?
I work in the aerospace industry. I do quality control parts testing. So that's I make cool. sure the parts that go on your airplanes do exactly what they're designed to.
That was fairly similar at one point in time in automotive, except specifications for subframes. Anyway, mm-hmm.
I mean it's good honest work. It pays very well, and but every now and then you get on these projects where you're doing what they call qualification and endurance and safety of flight, and those take time. You've got to put stuff through its paces. 10,000 cycles uninterrupted, and that's why we end up going to these 24-hour shifts. Yeah. Yeah, it can be. But you know what? I would not give this job up to go back to a freaking call center. I'm listening to you talk about that stuff. I worked internet tech support for almost 4 years. Never again.
Oh,
never no, again yeah. will I work a call center.
I'm in IT and I would never want to do internet tech support
mm-hmm.
again.
You have a special hatred for humanity after working that job 8 hours a day. And that's if you get out after 8 hours.
Yeah.
If you're still alive.
But yeah. I do some mercenary IT work on the side. So I'm still in that. In
more
that
mercenaries? Nice.
Yeah. Now contract work and whatnot, you know. So, yeah, I'm trying to get back into IT full time, but, you know, getting back into the industry when you've left it for so long and you don't have the letters behind your name and the certifications that are required to even get your foot in the door makes it very, very difficult, especially when you hit your mid-40s.
Oh, but I bet you could do it. And some things are a little easier right now because of having a hard time finding people. What do you want to do or specialize in?
Mostly back-end network administration, and then I actually thrive in that user-facing role. Again, the 4 years of internet tech support, there's nothing, no amount of stupidity that I haven't seen or can handle.
Yeah.
So I was, I used to work for Earthlink and AT&T back in the day, AT&T WorldNet Service.
Oh, jeez, that's the old school call.
Yeah. And I used to keep a stack of Dixie cups on my desk for when I'd get special calls. And I used to do a lot of my skill set included deaf and blind, which those were always fun. But when you're working in a call center and time is a metric, I put these cups up so that my supervisor would know, hey, I'm on a deaf call. It's going to take longer. Hey, I'm on a blind call, which blind calls actually worked really, really good because the screen reader would tell me exactly what I need to know. And I just tell them to hit the key combination. And then I added my irate call and my ID10T cup as well. And they loved when I took irate calls because it saved them, you know, let me talk to your manager. Now, we're not going to do that today, sir. You're going to deal with me and I'm going to fix your problem. If you don't like that, you can call back and find someone else.
Yeah.
I'm the guy here to fix it.
Yep.
Fantastic.
But yeah, it meant that, you know, it screwed up my call metrics. They were expecting a certain volume in an 8 hour shift, and I was maybe hitting 2/3 of that on a good day. But what they weren't looking at is because they'd pull up the spreadsheets and they go, well, you know, you have one of the worst call times in the center. I said, well, what's my callback rate? Oh, it's one of the best. Oh, what's my transfer out rate? Oh, it's one of the best. I said, exactly. People get to me and that's the last time.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's better service than sending someone back into a half hour queue.
That's what I hated about that too. It's all about the numbers and the sales and the managers. And it, you know, when you do this and you enjoy it, I'm thinking about dealing with my customers. 80% of my calls will be like a 5, 10, 15 minute max thing. And then every once in a while, I'll have the customer I need to be on the phone for like an hour. But in the long run, you still can mostly do short calls. But if you're not going to help that person in the rare situations that needs to be on for an hour and actually they're happy because they got something solved, then what good are you as a tech support agent?
Yeah, and you'd think there's a certain level of goodwill you've built up for those, you know, for making the metric so often that, you know, an occasional 1 hour call shouldn't be that big a deal. But again, it's, you know, your numbers on a spreadsheet.
Yeah.
That's all it is.
Who knows? Maybe you can even just start up something on your own, work for your own, you know, and I know that's always hard, scary starting off that way.
Well, again, that's what I say. Like, I do mercenary work now. I've got a few friends that are in various places, and you know, next thing you know, I get a phone call. It's like, dude, we have an emergency here, and we need someone that understands networking. Can you come? And I'm like, sure. My rate's $125 an hour, and they go, cool, we're good with that. Awesome. See you in a few.
Nice. Yeah.
Right. And $125 is not bad.
That's good for California. I was going to say that's what I charge in Utah.
Right.
So that you're probably underpriced in California.
Yeah. But I'm also not bonded and insured. So there's it, right.
Well, nice. And speaking of, I'm excited to talk to you about, tell us about where you live.
I live in the San Fernando Valley of the Los Angeles, California area. I know one of you, I forget exactly which one is from this area at some point in time.
That's me, Kingsley Mac. Yes. Okay. I was born in Fullerton, California and lived in Roland Heights until I was about 22.
Nice. Yeah, I know that area well.
Yep. And I used to work at Disneyland too.
Everyone in that area did. I think that was every teenager in the Orange County area's first job at some point in time.
Oh yeah.
Either that or a movie theater.
Out of high school. Yeah. Or a movie theater. You're right.
Right. In my area, it was Magic Mountain.
Yes. Yeah. Magic Mountain, that area, Disneyland in our area, or if you couldn't get into Disneyland, then you worked at Knott's Berry Farm.
Oh, no.
Although that is a fun park. It's just,
it is now
for like people that work. It's not as good as Disneyland.
Right. I mean, I'll take Legoland over Knott's at this point.
That's awesome.
But I have two kiddos, so that makes the difference. I'm sure when they're old enough to enjoy roller coasters, and I swear if they don't enjoy roller coasters, I'm disowning them. Then maybe we'll start going to Knott's. But at the moment, they're a little too small. I've got one that's about to turn 5, and the other one that's 3.5.
Okay, so yeah, I mean, we know Magic Mountain well. What other things do you like to do in the area? I mean, that can be such a loaded question in California, but do you do any outside stuff like, beach or mountain or hiking or I
used to. I've pulled the California double of snowboarding in one day and going to the beach on the same day.
Mm-hmm.
And that was fun. But I'm not a big outdoorsy kind of guy. If I do anything outdoorsy, I like to camp up in the Big Bear area, up in the mountains. Beach tends to be just a little too hot for me. Yeah, I don't like cooking in the sun.
Yeah.
But I'm like, we'll get out, go camping. But for the most part, I'm kind of a homebody. At best, if I find the will to do it, I'll hop on my bike and I'll go for like a 15-mile ride.
Respectable.
Hmm?
Yeah, respectable for sure.
Yeah.
It's awesome. How's the weather right now? Is it still the thing where, summers can be a little hazy there at times, but winters are generally pretty clear and beautiful?
I think this was the most moderate winter we've had in a long time. I don't think at any point in time during the winter, the finger quotes winter, it dropped under 38. And if it did, it was for 4 days. Like, it's been absolutely beautiful out here. I think it hit 72 today, and I'm wearing a thermal or a hoodie when I drive in, because when I wake up in the morning, it's in the mid 40s, so I'll throw on like a flannel or whatnot, and by 9:30, it's like, get this thing off of me and throw it in my car or forget it at work. So, yeah, I mean, Elmer, I know you listen to this. Yes, we have beautiful weather here too. It's not just Gator.
I would say it's more temperate and beautiful in California because you don't have to deal with the humidity as much as Florida.
Oh, definitely not. I lived in Pensacola for just over a year. As beautiful as the Gulf Coast is, couldn't do it. And I know Dez is familiar with that region's humidity.
Yeah.
Sweat dripping everywhere.
Mm-hmm. But hey, sweat dripping everywhere in your house with the air conditioning on.
That's right.
Oh, man. And you have a family, two kids, two little ones?
Yep. I got two little girls, and obviously the wife is still around. I haven't gotten rid of her yet.
Haven't traded her in?
Well, I think I need to keep her because I'm surprised she hasn't traded me in yet. I'm definitely an older model.
Excellent.
Is that a problem?
There's no, we got a 10-year age gap between us, so.
Okay.
Yeah. I definitely scored on that one. But yeah, no, beautiful family. I've been married for what is this? 6 years now, going on 7, and yeah, and it basically waited until we were ready to have kids, and then, you know, tied the knot and did the kid thing.
That's awesome.
It's yeah, it's been a wild ride. I never, you know, having my first kid at 42 was just like, what am I thinking, right? Like I expected to have my kids in my 30s, and when it didn't happen, when I started hitting the late 30s, I was just like, well, okay, it's just not going to happen. I'm good with it. And then stuff happens, you know, a bottle of wine and, hey, how you doing?
How you doing?
Right.
How you doing?
And then, you know, 2 months after that, you know what, honey, it might be stress, but I haven't like had something happen in 2 months now. Maybe we should go take a test. So, yeah.
And then there's kids.
And then there's kids. And then we did it again. The first night that my oldest fell asleep without crying, fussing, whining, the second one was conceived.
Ooh.
So, yeah, they're 15. They're 15 and a half months apart.
Okay.
Yeah. They're close together, at least.
Yeah. That's a blessing and a curse. It does have its good days, and some days it doesn't. But, yeah, like we're getting through a lot of the phases. You know, bada bing, bada boom, it's done. Like we're about to be completely done with potty training this year.
Oh, nice.
So, and, yeah.
It's kind of good actually being, yeah, the ages close together. I think that's good. Especially if, I don't know if you're planning on having any more, but if not, then you're in a perfect situation now.
Now that I leave that for my brother-in-law and her sister, who they had their first child, 18 months after my youngest, we've got 3 girls in the family, all within 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe they're going to start trying for their second, like now. Like they might be doing it as we speak.
Live update. We can have live updates from other people too.
Yeah, we are hoping that it, you know, when that time comes and they have their second one, it's not a boy, because that poor boy is going to have 3 of the most rambunctious and outspoken women right ahead of him. Like he doesn't have a chance.
Ooh, yeah. That would be interesting for sure. Well, you have a lot of cool, interesting projects and things that you're involved in. And let's talk about this for a little bit. I don't know where to start. I mean, you can tell me if you've worked on other interesting things, and Des might know more too, but at least let's start talking about Guardians Mental Health.
Ah, yes. That was a project that I got involved with, ironically enough, because of having 2 children in a very short time span. Shortly after my second was born, and you know, still being kind of that new dad, you know, with the first one, it's all fine and good, because you got mom's doing most of the breastfeeding, taking care of baby for the, you know, I had to change a couple of diapers, and you know, the menial, like the bare minimums. And it wasn't, you know, that I didn't want to, it's just I didn't need to, because she was there for it. But when she got pregnant with the second one, suddenly she can't do all these things, and a lot of stuff fell on my lap in a big old hurry. And this was also going through some very transitional times at work, and a lot of things came to a head with my mental state that left me not in a good headspace. And I believe it was right around that time that Average Joe had done a guest spot on one of the many Destiny podcasts that I listened to. And he was talking about, at that point, I think it was, I don't know if it was still Saint 14 Project or if it was Project Guardians, but he was talking about it, and just something about it just spoke to me. I was like, I think this is where I need to be right now. Because again, gaming community, Guardians, like Destiny's been my game for probably an unhealthy amount of time at this point. I dropped my head in the server and just started talking with people, and I don't have an issue opening up about my past. It's I'm not ashamed of it. But you know, I think a lot of people can learn and relate, and it's good knowing that there's someone else out there that's also experiencing some of these things. So I kind of had a good foothold with that community in a hurry, because I was very open and honest with people, one, about my situation, and two, about just being able to talk with people and talk people through stuff. And the next thing you know, it's I think at that point in time, Chris3711 was still on the server. I get this message on the side. It's like, you know, you might be, would you be interested in doing some moderation for us? You seem to be very good with the community. I stepped up and said, sure, yeah, let me at it. I've been doing it since. I think I'm going on almost 3 years with the organization. We've done the podcast together. I head the moderation team. So I'm always looking within our community and within other communities for people that would like to come in and do moderation for us that would want to work in that capacity. And we like bringing people up from within, because obviously they've built a rapport. And, you know, when you get into a space like that, trust is a key factor. So, yeah, having someone that's already been there, having those conversations with you, it's a little easier to transition them. But we've had a couple of people come in from the outside that just have knocked it out of the park, and they're right there every bit as good as anyone that's been in. It's been so fulfilling to do this and to see the difference it's made, and to know that people have benefited from just having my ear listen to them.
For sure.
Right.
Let's just talk about, for those not aware or forgotten, basically what Guardians Mental Health is. I mean, you guys have a website, a Discord. How would you explain it for someone who is not aware there's a resource like this?
We offer peer support through a Discord server. It's actually partnered in discord.gg/guardiansmh, where, you know, we have some, my children just got home, sorry. Caught them out of the corner of my ear. We have trained medical professionals on our staff that make sure that all of the resources that we provide are vetted and qualified. They're not, snake oil salesmen. And then we have the moderators that that basically we're the outreach to the community. We're an ear for them. And then with that going, we started reaching out into other avenues, doing conventions and whatnot, and the Guardians Mental Health Kit program was something that was it was born out of going to conventions, but when the pandemic hit, obviously conventions were just gone, right? Yeah. But the need to have those resources available to the community, and not just, you know, people that came to us, to be able to put them out into the world, was something that was very important to Joe. So he put together this program, and, you know, where we assemble mental health kits with, printed resources. We have a coloring book that is co-designed by artists in our community. And they're all themed around each particular kit that we do. The last one we did was actually a partnership with Bungie, and that one's taken off like gangbusters. I think we've had close to 4,000 orders for it.
Wow.
Yeah, and this is something that we all hand pack them ourselves. It's not something we farm out to like a fulfillment center. So we order everything in, we get it all printed up, we ship it out. See, he ships out, you know, Joel shipped me out like 100 kits, and I'll assemble them here in my office. And then, yeah, get them out to the community members, and we provide these things for free. They're fully funded by either streams we do or donations from the community. So, and that, again, every time I see something come up on the Guardian's Twitter of, I got my kit and it came at just the right time, or I got the kit and the printed resources are amazing, or I got the kit and I love the little fidget toy that's in it. Like, there's something of value for everybody in these kits. And again, some of the most fulfilling work I think I've ever done.
I hear you, man. Yeah. That is amazing. And it is awesome, the work that you all do. I've seen the tweets of Joe posting pictures of assembling those kits, or I've seen the tweets of people saying that they've received them. And of course, like you mentioned, the partnership with Bungie, mm-hmm. and the Discord too is just amazing. I mean, it's been around forever and a great resource for people to hop in any aspect. If you feel like you need support, if you know someone that needs support, if you just want to be more informed, mm-hmm. it's a great resource to hop in there and get links, get information, get people to talk to if you need.
I promise 100% I will never, ever, ever kick everyone out of the server again.
Wait, what happened?
Wait, what?
That sounds like a fun story.
Intrigued.
we were making some changes to the Discord. We have rules. Like, every Discord has a set of rules. Because of the nature of what we do, and with legalities concerned, we had to enforce 18 over rule in there. But for the most part, at that time, you'd come in, and sure, there was a rules channel, but there was nothing in there compelling you to read it. Discord didn't have the thing that they have now, where when you join a server, it's got a pop-up and a checkbox, I agree to these terms, right? There was none of that. So we had to build that from the ground up. And in the conversations, it was like, okay, we got to do this. It's got to be role assigned. I'm like, cool. We had everything set up. There was no discussion of whether we were grandfathering anyone in that was already in the server. So when I clicked the switch to set the rules in place, it basically removed the role from everybody in the server and limited them to two channels. Yeah. So
you didn't actually happened kick them on out. You just limited them.
Oh yeah. But nobody, that's like cool. We lost a lot of people because there were people that were actively chatting. As soon as they pop back in, it was just like, there's two channels, and you start seeing the logs go, this person has left, this person has left, person has left. And it's like, oh no.
What have I done?
I've never been in more fear for my job than I was in that moment. Because I think at that point I had only been moderating for 3 months. Oh, I took Lord. The entire Guardian's mental health community and said, yeah, out.
Oh, yeah, those things happen.
Yeah, they do.
Yeah, we all have some crazy story at like a job that we did something kind of oopsie, but hey.
Oh, if you work IT, yeah, you click the wrong button and yeah, the permissions are removed and suddenly no one can get anywhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
When you get that message on your screen that says the administrator account has been disabled, please contact your administrator.
Oh, I love that wording. But yeah, great Discord. Oh, and I think it's great that we have these resources in the community, and people are not afraid as much these days to say like, hey, let's talk about stuff. Let's not shun talking about needing support with whatever.
It is definitely gotten better, and right? I will credit, like, I can't tell how many times I've listened to your cast and you guys touch on it. Des especially, you know, has been very forthcoming and very open about mental health in his past. And it's like those conversations are what is making this better and easier for the community, because a lot of us, especially us guys, have this stigma put on us that, you know, boys don't cry, toughen up, man up, grow a pair, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right. And we don't feel comfortable talking with our peers, especially other men. Yeah. You know, with my own therapist, you know, we had this conversation before, and I'm like, how many of your male colleagues have other male clients? And she goes, not very many, because most men will not open up to another male even their therapist. They would prefer to have a female therapist.
Yeah.
So the fact that these conversations are happening is what's making that difference. And the fact that more people are coming out and being more comfortable with it is what's making that difference. And then we're in a position to be there when that conversation starts to happen. And that's the other key part of that. You know, sure, it's great that you can, okay, great, I feel comfortable. Now what? Who do I talk to? Where can I feel safe? That's where something like Guardian's Mental Health comes in.
Exactly, yeah. And I want to remind everyone, this is nothing compared to the resources you guys have in your Discord, but because of this, and then other people had recommendations, I forget who it was. I think it was someone like Dez or Ninja Muffin or something, but we even created a little channel in our Discord called Guardian Grief. And it's just even a small aspect that I would have never thought to have something like this in a Discord, that, hey, if you're having hard time with something, it's a channel where you can just write your feelings. And the main point is for people to not try to say like, well, this is how you can make it better. No, the main point is to commiserate, maybe say nothing at all if you're not sure, and then the person can feel better. And then maybe you can have a conversation, DM later or whatever, or give more mm-hmm. resources. But I don't know. It's just amazing that, you know, we don't have to be afraid to have these discussions these days.
And it all starts with that first step. Having a place to do it, having a place where you can feel safe doing it.
Exactly. Yep. You got to feel safe too. Awesome, man. Well, yeah. And if we have any more questions about this going forward, we'll continue to talk about it. What other projects do you work on? Any other podcasts or fun things?
Because, you know, we just had this wonderful pandemic starting in, 2020. And when you're cooped up in the house with expensive equipment, what else is there to do but, you know, start a podcast?
Yeah.
And because I was doing the co-hosting stuff with Guardians, I was like, well, maybe we can, you know, maybe I can do something on my own. And my brother-in-law and I put together I'm two episodes back on editing because I'm a lousy podcast host, but we have a a podcast it's the Whiskey Podcast, and it's whiskey, parenting, and life. And we, you know, basically we sample a whiskey, you know, start off with that social lubricant, get into the heavy parenting topics, and then, you know, we'll finish it off with some gaming news and whatnot, just because both my brother-in-law and I are big gamers. I think he's more of a gamer than I am, because he likes those wood chopping simulators that I just can't do. Yeah, I knew you'd laugh at that, Dez. So we do that. I think we just wrapped episode 34. We try to do it bi-weekly, life allowing. That's been fun. It pushed me to get some better equipment so that I can do this on a more professional sounding basis. Other, you know, the stuff I had before was, it got by. No one complained about my audio. It's pushed us to kind of push the envelope and get better at what we do. That's my other pet project. And then I'm also on a third podcast that ironically enough, Dez, was Buster Knuckles' old side project.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
I remember you talking about that.
Yeah. God, so, yeah, when I back in the days of the RNG cast, you know, I followed you both, and then that's how I ended up finding the fork in your ear, that he was also co-hosting on. And then when your guys's lives found a way to keep you from doing this, they're left a void. And because I was part of that community as well, it was again, my co-host over there was just like, I don't know. I think I might shut this down unless I, you know, does someone want to come in and maybe co-host an episode with me? And I'm like, you know, again, here I am doing nothing and I got a microphone to spare. Sure. I'll do it. So here I am a year later doing that one.
Nice.
And that one's kind of a round table, again, mixed bag. Entertainment, video games, technology, kind of cover the range, and life as well, cover the range of topics on that one. So yeah,
excellent.
Those are the places you can find my wonderful voice.
Yes. And on a podcast circuit, also through the Destiny podcasts right now.
Yeah. I've done this show now. By the time this is wrapped, you know, Guardian, obviously the other Guardian podcast, they had me on twice, so you got to catch up to them. Yeah.
Uh-oh.
If you want to have me back after this
one. We do. Of course.
my clan leader, Dan Finity, had me on one of his little side projects as well. The Beardo podcast. I think I was his second guest on that as well. So yeah, I don't mind getting in front of a mic, as much as it stresses me out sometimes.
Oh, we're scary. That's Cyn over there.
I know. Multitasking and podcasting and.
Here's the funny thing, because I've been listening to you longer than you've been listening to me. I know much more about you than you do of me.
Nice.
Like, I pictured you saying that in an Ace Ventura voice right there. I don't know why. And there's nothing you can do about it.
Nothing you can do about it.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, I go way back in the Destiny community again. Yeah. I've known Dez's voice for a long, long time now.
Right.
So.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, even though I had the idea to start this podcast, my two co-hosts have been doing podcasting longer than me, so it's kind of funny how that works.
but that's how these things succeed, right? You get what you don't have in skills, you get other people that can kind of fill that void, right?
Well, I don't know about Cyn, but Dez definitely.
he does bring a little something special to the table.
Dez has good opinions and has excellent information, but Cyn, I don't know.
I bring the shenanigans and the editing.
Every tag team needs its heel.
Wouldn't that make us a tripod, though?
That would make you a tripod.
A tripod. Someone kick one of those legs down. Oh, man.
Yes, yeah. They do. They, as Hazel would put it, they keep you around for your editing skills.
Ooh, cracked editor. I mean, it's true.
And there's really nothing anything special about it. Sometimes I put a little more effort than in, and sometimes I don't. I learned a long time ago to not be as picky with it. And I used to spend days, hours, like, hours each day over the course of 2 or 3 days, editing, listening, tweaking, going back, replaying what I edited, moving forward, splicing, taking out breaths. Like, it was like legit. I was like spending way too much time on it.
I will give it one honest pass. Like, I don't half-ass the first pass. I will start from the beginning, and you know, it's I would say 2.5 to 1, minute to minute ratio. So if I've got a 60 minute episode, it's going to take me an hour and a half, almost maybe an hour 45 to do a good edit on it. But I'm thorough with it. But I even need to scale back on some of that. I go back and I listen to it and I just go, I mean, it's a good edit. I'm fine with it, but did I really need to tighten it up that much?
Yeah.
And no, but Sin, I really appreciate, like when we were first getting started, you definitely brought in a lot of the guests too and got some good people on the show that, you know, surprised we get some cool people and stuff like that. So go ahead and continue to bring in the guests, Des and Sin. Kind of on a kick right now with lots of cool people. And so
I've had a few people that I messaged. And if they listen, they need now to answer their DMs. They have to answer their DMs.
Do it. Do it now.
Do it.
Don't make me find you. I'm probably in your Discord.
Oh, man. Yeah, we'll get everyone on it. So you're in a lot of Discords, Destiny community. I mean, how long have you played Destiny for? And yeah, let's just start with that.
I picked up Destiny 2 days after it actually officially released. I did not get in on the beta because I'm an Xbox player, and definitely didn't get in on the alpha. But yeah, day 2, and again, I'm a 46-year-old gamer. I cut my teeth on the classics, you know, the Castle Wolfenstein. Halo was my jam. It was hands down the best shooter of its era. I don't think anyone can disagree with that, even if they don't like it. It was still the best shooter of its era. And so when Destiny was, rumored to be coming out, it was like, I'm interested, but I wasn't getting a whole lot of chatter on it. At least, you know, I wasn't digging deep into it. But you know, my wife and I, we loved doing couch co-op. So we're like, well, here comes another Bungie game. If it's anything, if it's even close to, bringing back those old Halo feels on cooperative, fuck, we're down. So we got it, found out there was no split screen. We were very upset, which ended up, I think, the Christmas right after release, my wife ended up buying a second Xbox 360 and a 55-inch TV for me to play in my office so we could co-op together.
Wow.
Yes, guys, if you can marry a gamer, it does have its benefits.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I'm there too, although my gamer wife is kind of slacked off of more in paying attention gaming and moved more to just like gaming on her phone and TV, but at least she appreciates my gaming for the most part. I mean, always there's times, but you know what I mean? But for the most part, she appreciates it.
But yes, I mean, so that was my drop into Destiny. And then, you know, of course you start running into the end game content and we're like, well, you know, we don't know a lot of people that play Destiny, and the few that we do are all over on PlayStation, because PlayStation was where it was at for most of the people we knew that were Destiny diehards because they got in on the alpha, et cetera, et cetera. So we ended up kind of patching together a 4-person fire team from amongst the friends we had, and we started our own little personal clan so that we could, get the XP benefits of that. And, you know, we ran with that for a long time. Eventually ended up getting enough people to do a raid. Around what was the second raid?
Crota, I think.
Was it Crota? I always mix those up. Did Crota come before Vault, or was it the other way around? Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Must have Gjallarhorn. Right.
Yes.
So yeah, by that time it was like, okay, well, we finally have enough friends that we could actually do Crota. And it was like, well, you know, then trying to get those 6 people on at the exact same time, it was just such a chore. I dropped off for a while, and again, I didn't know this community existed, and I don't know that it really did back then as much, you know, especially not to the extent it does now. I had no concept of Twitch streamers doing this. You know, it's all foreign to me. Again, old man, you know, shouts at clouds. I'm just trying to play a damn game here and getting roadblocked the entire way because like, oh, you need six people, or when you finally do have them, must have Gellerhorn. But yeah, like those were the early days. But I've stuck through it. I love this franchise. Even through its faults, there's stuff in this week's TWAB that I'm just like, really? But they got their hooks in me. I'm not going to be an apologist, but I'm probably going to give them my money when Witch Queen comes out. This is the first one I actually haven't pre-ordered.
No, that's fine. That's respectable. So, and on the topic, how much do you play these days? Kind of
again, being a dad of two girls, it doesn't leave a lot of time. If I'm lucky, I'll get 4 hours of game time in a week.
Play occasionally. It's just,
I do. Yeah. Enough to log in and steal my clan engrams and,
get the weekly stuff.
Yeah, get my 700 bright dust from the store and see what emotes, which I saw them today. I need to pick up a couple of them. But yeah, like for the most part, even now, like my wife is putting the girls to bed, and then she's going to fire up Destiny. And from 8:30 to 10 o'clock, that's basically our time to game together. It's not as nice as cuddling, but in some ways it's a little bit better. I think we talk more when we game together than we do when we're sitting on the couch just watching a show.
Yeah. That kind of makes sense in a way. What do you like to do in the game the most? You know, assuming you had time. I mean, I meant that in a way like, yeah, if you had to get a fire team to do Iron Banner or Raid or whatever. But yeah, what do you just like to do most of the game?
You know, and that's an interesting question because, like, a little bit of everything, not called Gambit.
oh, come on.
I love...
So that's your least favorite.
Gambit. And I didn't hate Gambit until they did the latest whatever Gambit is currently. That's always like I'm done with it. It's not fun for me anymore. At least in its previous, like when they split the two, when they had Gambit and Gambit Prime, I at least didn't feel like I was sweating my balls off every time I tried to just go in and casually have fun with it. And I don't even care about winning. I don't care about my KD ever. I just like to enjoy what I'm doing. And I don't now with Gambit, but every other bit of this game, like I even love losing in trials. Like I'll lose trials every freaking match and enjoy myself. I enjoy going into the raids and pounding my head against a wall and hearing the other members of my fire team go, right. And it never, it's inevitable because, but you have to find that right group of people that, you know, they'll sigh, but they'll keep plugging through it with you because we're all just having a good time. It's not like, okay, guys, we have to get this done in the next 20 minutes. It's, you know, hey, we're just going to go in here and have fun. And if we win, we win. If we don't, well, maybe we'll try it again tomorrow if we have the checkpoint. I love going out and doing patrols. I hate fetch quests. That's like the bounty system we have now is kind of a problem for me because it just seems like go out and do this thing this specific way and then come back to do another thing a very specific way, and then come back. I just like going, like, drop me in the cosmic realm and I'll just do laps and just, you know, have fun. I'm so casual with the game, a lot of the systems that are in place now to keep people engaged and challenged are kind of off-putting.
I hear you. So maybe not as interested in like those seasonal weekly challenges and things like that.
If I get them done, I get them done. I pick them up. It's Glimmer. Like I get Glimmer back. So I'll pick them up. And if I see the thing pop up on the right of my screen, I go, oh, cool. Piece of candy.
Piece of candy.
Right?
Ooh, piece of candy.
Yeah, exactly.
Something.
But that's it. Like, I'll go in, I'll pick up all my bounties, and half the time all my bounties expire, except for the weeklies, obviously. And and even some of those expire because I don't get a chance to get back on. And I don't care that they expire. It's only Glimmer. I can get Glimmer. Like, I've got enough planetary materials from just, you know, shooting things in the face and then stuff dropping naturally that's like, okay, I go to Spider and refill all my Glimmer again. I don't ever feel like I'm resource poor in this game.
Yeah, I mean, anyone who's been playing for a while. It kind of can be that way.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I think I have a feel for kind of like what you like to do in the game. And do you have any like interesting stories or things you're proud of that you can think of thinking back in the game at any point?
You know, the first time clearing King's Fall, I think, is everyone's like crowning achievement. You know, a majority of people, I would say, not everyone's, just that feeling because of how that raid was set up. Like, I remember the first time I cleared King's Fall, and it was again with a ragtag bunch of, you know, four different clans got together, and we were all friends with someone else. And it was like, oh, well, you know, someone's got to go to sleep. Okay, well, let's pull this person in, this person in, this person in, this person in. And it was just the right mix and mojo of everyone, again, just having a good time, getting along, not really giving two craps about, you know, doing it absolutely perfect. And that was the first time I cleared it. It was, again, when it happened, I was like, dude, did we just win? And like, yeah. Yeah. You just beat King's Fall. I'm like, oh shit. Holy crap. Like, that was amazing. So yeah, that moment there, I think, epitomizes my Destiny experience. And then the only other real highlight that I have was the one lighthouse clear I have in Destiny 1. It's the only lighthouse clear I have the entire game. It was, and it happened to be Dr. Lupo and Ninja Noel raffle.
Ooh, nice.
Right.
Yeah.
Back in those days. And that was, again, just silly good time. Cause neither, again, common refrain here. Neither one of those two, while being very good at the game, ever took themselves so seriously that you were just like, okay, I'll just stand here and shoot something. They'll let you have fun. They'll let you lose. They'll let you win. They'll never, you know, they never berated you for making a stupid play unless you were being like, unless your tactic was wrong, like from the get go, I'm going to run and stick my head in a sniper lane every single time. Then they'd go, yeah, let's chill back for a second here. Right. Let me give you a little coaching point. But at no point in time were they like, dumbass, don't do that. Right.
Yeah.
So
to be fair, I would do that myself. So, you know,
and that's okay. I will never do trials with you because of that. but that's that kind of thing. Like, I remember that moment because this is the, you know, the pinnacle competitive thing in Destiny at the time. And I never felt so stressed that I was going to disappoint someone or that I was going to, you know, fuck it up for the rest of the team. So that's the experience I look for in Destiny. And those two moments there those are my highlights because, again, that's what I want from this game.
It really is. To have
fun. Yeah.
Yeah. I think, and that's the great thing about all our groups of communities is I would say 99% of the people you deal with, we try to have that same mentality of, you know, if there's times where we have to be try hard for trials or certain raid or something, but generally we're going to be like, yeah. We will not, you know, be a place. Sure.
And again, I don't begrudge anyone that wants to be try hard for trials. But you have your teams for that. Like,
yeah. You announce it ahead of time. Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, no, those are some cool experiences and stories that you mentioned there. Any other questions, Des or Cyn, for N8FOO before we move on to our Destiny topics? We do have a few we need to get into tonight for sure. Cyn, live update, what are you doing?
We could jump into it. Live update, I'm just triumph grinding or hunting right now. Since the start of the podcast, I did finish the solo Legend Lost Sector on the moon, and I did solo Flawless the Master Lost Sector on the moon.
Show off.
And it's a raid.
Thank you for just being solo. While I'm doing a podcast. While I'm over here saying, I just want to have fun.
Nice. I know, right?
And I've been working on this Ether event on the Tangled Shore as well. I've made a little bit of progress on that. Yeah.
And you're probably triple dipping on your bounties, right?
No, I don't mess with bounties.
Okay.
My name's not Gator. Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see you standing there, Gator.
And there, awkwardly in the corner.
I can.
Hello.
Although I did start saving some for the start of the new season, just for the little bit of XP boost, but it's like 2-on-1 and 4, 5, or 6 or something like that on the other one.
No, like I meant like getting 3 bounties that all have a similar, you know, objective. That's kind of stuff. That.
Yeah,
I'm so bad at that.
Yeah. The only reason I do it is just because I don't want to waste a bunch of time doing it on like 3 different times.
Mm-hmm.
So when I do need to do them, I try to maximize as much as I can. Oh, I need to use a sword. I need to use a pulse rifle and a fusion or a special and finishers. Okay. And I'm going to work all of them at the same time while I'm doing something else that I also need to work on. And that way I can just get it all done. And it's just really a lack of time.
Sure. I applaud your efficiency on that. It is something I am not good at. Like, I can't tell you how many times I picked up a bounty and then I go somewhere to another vendor. I pick up a bounty and go, I just did that. I just did 50 scout rifle kills. This one was 25. I could have knocked them both out at the same time. Ugh.
Yeah, and I do them like all the strike ones at once if I'm going to do them. And then I do all the crucible. With crucible, if it's a weapon I don't like, I'm not going to do it. It'll just disappear.
Yep.
Gambit. Yeah. I'll switch things up because I really don't care too much. I don't need to focus. It's just more casual for me. And I'll do as many of them as I can at once. And that's typically all I really ever do. Sometimes I'll do the raid and like clan night bounties. I'll do those when I remember to pick them up. That's mostly it. And shout out to Nalsy. I haven't played with him in a while, but he always used to call me out for like, you seriously jump around from one activity to the next. It's like, I want to do stuff and I don't want to just sit here and grind out Altars of Sorrows until the Triumph is done. I'm going to do a couple. I'm going to switch to something else. I'll come back. Like, that's what I was doing with the Ether Harvest bounty, where you have to do that on the Tangled Shore for the Triumph. Mm-hmm. I saw a couple pop up. I joined them. I went out. I did a Law Sector. I came back and did another, public event. Then I went and did the solo Flawless Master. And honestly, it's not that hard doing it because I know if I go in too fast, I'm going to just die. So as we were talking, like, I would just sit in a corner and heal. And then I'd go back out, clear a couple ads, hide, go out, clear a couple ads and hide. I just took it slow, and which is probably one of my biggest downfalls, why I haven't done those with the dungeons yet, is because I lacked the patience to spend a dungeon that's already going to take an hour or more, 2 or 3 hours, just to slow play it and get through it and solo flawless it. It gets a little bit boring at some point, and I just want to get it done. So then I start going full bore, and it's doesn't work.
Yeah, and once it gets boring is when I'm just done with it. Like, I'll just let the bounty expire.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, we all have our different styles. Yeah, I get what you're saying, Sin, too. For me, it's like, I don't like to multitask as much, and I can focus on doing the solo flawless, but I won't get bored, but I'll get, like, tired, if that makes sense. Like, I can't focus any more mental ability on it. I'm, like, getting overwhelmed. And right. I'm like, I just got to be done, you know? So, different ways to look at it, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
For sure.
And especially when you look at what are you getting out of it? Another purple you're probably going to shard?
Yeah, I didn't care too much about the drops at this point. Maybe some of the exotics that I don't have, but I haven't really been pushing for them. If they drop, great. It's more so the Triumph points at this point. I kind of had it in my mind at some point, a few weeks or a month or so back, that I really wanted to hit 20,000 for active Triumph score. Okay. And as I've gotten closer and
Because then we get sent a gold star in the Discord.
it's nice. It's just a little something extra. A
little sticker version.
I'm only 800 triumph score away, and hopefully if we can get this Petra's done, it'll take 300 of that off, and I'll be that much closer.
Yeah, I mean, I commend you. I have one of my best friends that was part of my original fire team is absolutely a completionist and is now currently playing on my brother-in-law's account because she's like, I'm done with everything and I still want to play. So can I hop on your account and grind stuff out for you? So, right, like for the challenge. Like, okay.
Yeah, definitely sounds like the achievement type player.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Oh, that's cool. That's interesting in a way. Oh, just quick. I just want to mention, because I'm kind of proud of this, it's been a long time coming, and I know Zebrak got it also, but finally got my Enlightened title. That is the Garden of Salvation raid title for
okay.
For explaining. And in some aspects, you could say it's easier because you don't have to go flawless like you do on Last Wish. However, I still say it's almost harder in a way, because all the Last Wish challenges aren't too bad for the most part, but almost every, and Cyn and others can attest to this, almost every single challenge in the Garden Raid is very, very difficult. And there's a lot of them.
I look at so that. Are you proud of that achievement?
I am, yes.
That's all that matters. Yep. It doesn't matter if it's hard, easy. It's all that matters is you're proud of that achievement. I have zero titles because I don't care.
Yeah, that's right. Fair. Yeah.
So.
Totally fair. But yeah, it's been a while since I've had something in the game where I've kind of been like, oh, this is nice to have. And it was kind of nice to get that yesterday. And, you know, I've been having fun with the game still, but like there hasn't been anything big for a while, if that makes sense. Of course, with the new Witch Queen, there'll be the raid and it'll be fun when we pass the raid and all that stuff. But yeah, there hasn't been much lately.
Yeah, I mean, if you can get to light level.
Will we ever? well, there's stuff to talk about for sure.
Yes.
Twab time. Yeah, the twab.
Twab.
Get down low and hit it.
You want to talk about the twab now?
I think so. At Bungie? Yeah.
I mean, there's stuff to talk about.
Yeah, there's words, as Des would say.
I was just about to summon my blue eyes. No, I'm kidding. Actually, not really. But... also, for a note, there's actually a new free-to-play Yu-Gi-Oh! Game that has recently, very recently dropped within the past like day. So, yeah.
A what game?
Yu-Gi-Oh!
For any other card on anything, practically. Mobile, console, PC, name it, download it, play it.
Have you not heard of Yu-Gi-Oh, Cyn?
No, I have.
Oh, okay.
I thought that's what I heard. I just wanted to clarify.
Yeah. I used to play back in the day. Like, far more than I should probably admit.
Nice.
We say this as my brother-in-law is currently getting my daughters into Pokemon. As long as he's the one financing it, I don't care.
Right.
Hmm.
And also, Carpal, if you like card games with overly complicated rules and small text, you'll love it. In here. So, this week at Bungie. I'm going to go ahead and say this up front. Kind of like Lester, I thought. Kind of like Lester. Sure. But I guess it is the starting information to give us for new stuff.
Well, it is a DMG twab, so it's a lot of words saying nothing.
Interesting. Fair. I had I'll never thought of that.
Right. But no, the first thing to talk about, of course, is the new hour. Of course, this is a new expansion. So I guess we aren't entirely familiar with power gains for expansions.
Mm-hmm.
But they do discuss the power floor, the soft cap, the power cap, and the hard cap. And I swear they've added another cap since the last time they've explained this.
Well, I swear they've changed the wording. They used to call hard cap pinnacle cap at one point, I feel like, but maybe
they
not.
Never really discussed the floor, I think, is what. Like, yeah, we've always had the soft right. cap and yes, the power
yeah,
cap.
Yeah.
Really, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Well, the floor, which, as some people may, I mean, the easiest way to explain is when you pull out something brand new, it goes to 1100 powers. When Guardians first start, everything is at 1100 power. Mm-hmm. 1100, 11,000? Could it be 11,000?
1,100.
1,100. There we go.
11 million.
Right.
The decimus is 11.
There's an 11 in there.
And some zeros.
Right. Once Witch Queen drops that number of 11, will increase to 1350.
Mm-hmm. Arbitrary.
So, yeah. I mean, it's extraordinarily arbitrary and also devalues any and all grinding you've done this season. Congratulations.
Yes, yeah. It's an arbitrary number that ended up being extremely disrespectful.
And you know what? Classic MMO stuff. I love it. All that hard work.
Normal. Haven't they pretty much done this every big expansion?
No. They when they do the expansion, they've kept the floor at the hard cap, not the power cap.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, good point. Yeah. Good point. I was thinking it of a different way, but yeah. Okay.
Yeah, this is legitimately, if you've hit Pinnacle this season, congrats, you're on par for when Witch Queen drops.
Right.
I see.
My brother-in-law that hasn't played this entire season, that is currently at 1308 base, and
we'll be 1315.
We'll be 1350, and Cyn, who's ground this out and hit 1330 base, will be 1350.
Yep.
So
everything you've done,
because I was not paying attention. Yeah. I think because they like. Done... Oh, go ahead. Yeah.
No, I was gonna say go ahead because I'm about to make a joke.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because mine isn't jokey. But no, I was thinking mine's boring. Maybe they're just doing these numbers because when we talk later, the 1500 numbers sound cool. I don't know.
I mean, I don't know.
That's a bad reason to do things.
Right. And congratulations, everything you've just done for the past 3 months is for nothing. All right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, literally.
All right, I'll stop talking.
I actually feel bad for my friends that have ground this out because I was...
I know.
I haven't played, and I'm like, you know, and to my benefit, every time we get a new season or a new whatever drop, it's just like, oh man, I'm going to have to spend so much time just catching up to where everyone started.
Oh, wait, yeah, you make a good point, because the Pinnacle is 1330. Mm-hmm. 1350 is with Artifact. Oh, my God, they have literally...
Mm-hmm. They blew it out of the water, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is harsher than I thought then. Wow.
Yeah.
They're call center managers, and they're looking at numbers on a paper, right. And the number wasn't good enough, and they're just asking for more.
Mm-hmm.
This is legit MMO. It's like power creep right here. Oh, my God.
Right. Yeah, and I do want to mention, I'm not going to shout out any names, but I know there's someone who's listening live chat right now, or maybe not, maybe he'll be listening afterwards, but he's come back to the game a little more recently and has been messaging me some about like best ways to level up and stuff. And now we're just looking at this like,
don't
you may just want to wait a few weeks.
Yeah. Wait about 5 weeks. You're going to be great.
My brother-in-law did the exact same thing. He's like, is it worth coming back? I said, well, and before even knowing this today's TWAB, I was like, really, the only thing that, like, at this point you're going for is the chance to get the 30th anniversary stuff. Like, you're never, he's at 1308. You're not going to hit any appreciable power number this season, like, in the next 30 days or 60 days. Like, it's just not going to happen for you. So, like, the only reason you would come back would be for the 30th anniversary stuff, which is carrying over. So I'm like, not really. And then this dropped today, and I'm like, definitely not really. In fact, it's now pointless.
You could still run the raid if you don't have Vex. You could still run the raid for Eyes of Tomorrow. There's still reasons to do it. That's just if you're going to play some of the harder stuff, the GMs. Mm-hmm.
For Eyes and for Vex, are any of those going away?
Those two aren't.
No.
Yeah, I don't know about the DSC.
Again, I ask, why would I grind as a 1308 to get these things when I can just wait until the 22nd and do them as 1350?
All right. To be fair, though,
there's still a chance to get them, and it could take you 3 or 4 weeks of doing the activity to get it. So it doesn't hurt, and you can always infuse it later.
I'm sorry, Dez. I'm going to throw RNG in this one. I could get it the very first time I run it. It could still take me another 4 months. So that argument does not mean diddly to me, right?
It's only if you want to get it now.
Right. If you want to right at this now. Point, yeah. In his case, not my case, in his case, if he wants to struggle bus it, sure, knock yourself out. Well, but I couldn't give him a compelling reason to say, fire it up now. You must play for these things when this is now coming.
The other thing, to be fair, though, other than the Vault of Glass raid, the other raids are all way underpowered anyway. So even this season's floor pretty much covered them.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not going to be any better next season. You're already as good as you can be. You're already the 30 over or the 50 over or whatever they say. But Vault of Glass, yeah, could definitely. And that brings up some interesting points, and we're getting a little sidetracked here. They sometimes will raise like the Grandmasters and the current raid up anyway. So Vault of Glass may still be the same difficulty next season. So we don't know for sure, but yeah.
Oh, if they do that, so many people are going to be pissed.
Well, it happens. Why? Sometimes.
Because people are currently overleveled for it, and they're going to floor everyone at 1350 and raise the power level for a raid. No.
If I had to guess, what do you think, Diz? If I had to guess, they may not this time because it won't be the current raid anymore when the new raid comes out.
I anticipate them probably making it the floor. Because at that point, they'd almost have to.
Okay, raise it to 1350. What's it currently?
They didn't do that with the other raids, though. They only did it with Vault for a little bit when it was current. And then I feel like once the raids aren't current anymore, they don't raise it anymore. We'll see. We'll see.
Yeah,
I don't know. Yeah, we'll definitely see.
we'll know when our Twitter feeds blow up, right?
We're getting in the weeds, but it's still fun. Somewhat. Yeah.
So yeah, floor, soft cap, power cap, and hard cap.
Yes, which we already know how the others work. Soft cap is if you're below the soft cap, then anything you get across the board is going to apply to your power. It's all going to be upgrades. Absolutely everything up until 1500. Once you hit 1500, you are within power cap range, I suppose. Yes. And then, of course, the only thing, powerful drops stop being upgrades, so then you'll have to go towards pinnacle drops up to 1550. No, wait. I'm getting ahead of myself.
Your powerfuls will get you up to 1550. Get you up to 1550.
Then it's pinnacles to 1560. So they are still keeping the 10 light gap between hard and pinnacle, or power and pinnacle, whatever terms.
Hard pinnacle is hard. Powerful is power. Soft is. Whatever.
So, yeah, you get to basically blues will get you up to your 1500 arbitrary units. Your purples will get you to 1550 arbitrary units, and then pinnacles will get you to
1560.
Yeah.
Sir.
All right.
So of course, I guess overall strategy is do everything up until 1500, then to do your powerfuls, and then you're probably not going to be in range, but if you're close to range, then do your pinnacles, you know, or shoot the aliens in the face, play the game.
Yeah,
whatever.
You'll get there eventually. If you're not trying to week one it or day one it, just enjoy the game. Yeah. I'm sure if it's like anything else that, you know, when we've had to go 100, you know, or 50 to get to whatever the new floor or the new soft cap is, it happens pretty quickly, which again is why I just go, why did it? Okay. Arbitrary units.
Yeah. Like soft cap. Yeah. Soft cap is no big deal because again, literally anything you do is going to. Yeah. Like I said, historically soft caps are nothing. It's usually once you hit the power and the pinnacle grinds, things can start getting a little dicey, but Soft caps, nothing.
Nothing. Yep. Easy.
1500 looks real cool.
Yes, it's a cool it's looking nice, number, right?
It's a nice round. It's like a nice round number. It is a nice round number. And then of course they talk about economy.
Mm-hmm.
Which I do love this like initial joke. It's like designing an economy is easy, right? Short answer, no.
Absolutely not.
No, it's not. Stop it. In fact, we hear from a title I'm pretty sure they made up just before this TWAB. like, legitimately. The Economy Feature Lead, Joshua Kulinski?
Kulinski, like that, sure.
Yeah, I guess. But yeah, like I said, I'm pretty sure they thought of that title moments before this was published.
Is that a problem?
What do we call him? Something cool.
Yeah, because calling him a red shirt would have been too obvious.
Right. Cool. Right. Oof. Anywho, and I guess to cultivate goodwill, he opens up with no more blue drops, but not really, because you're still going to get blue drops, just not from the end of activities. But blues will still drop from enemies and chests, but not activities anymore.
Right.
So no more blue drops from the end of activities. Mm-hmm. So don't get that confused. It's not no more, well, that end after you hit the soft, or once blues stop powering you up, they'll stop dropping from the end of activities. So yeah, after you hit 1500, you'll see less blues.
Right.
Not. They'll probably be about cut. They'll probably be about cut in half if you're playing like strikes. Of course, if you're a Crucible guy, you're not going to see blues.
Because no, I mean, you shouldn't even see them in strikes either, or Gambit.
Well, I mean, come on. To be fair, they do mention that they are rethinking rarity in Destiny and what that will mean. They also warn that it's not going to be anytime soon that these talks are going to cultivate into anything we'll see, mm-hmm. but these talks are starting, so maybe next year. Maybe.
Here's a question I have, because they say playlist activities, but then they say Crucible Strikes, Gambit, etc. So I wonder if it's truly just playlist activities or like all activities, because I was doing some moon hunts earlier today and getting all these blues. I'm like, it'd be nice not to get them in there too, you know, later on. So I'm really curious what they mean by how many activities will or will not have the blues.
You know,
I guess like my read on that is if you're not doing something in the wild, yeah, you shouldn't see blues after 1500.
Okay, I hope not. But I just wasn't sure, because they say playlist activities also, so...
Because, mm-hmm. Well, we also know that Bungie has a distinct history of expertly utilizing terminology, let's say. Yeah, really.
Right, because even strikes have in-the-wild areas.
Yeah.
So
in other words...
Right. Exactly.
Just lots of...
There will be less blues. So happy day. And also, Banshee. He's getting a shuffle. Mm-hmm. A shuffle I actually wasn't really anticipating, but also seems to be the perfect thing they could do for Banshee. As hinted at on Twitter, they mentioned get rid of all your gunsmith materials. No, seriously, get rid of them or don't really. I mean, it doesn't really matter.
Or we'll take them from you forcibly.
Yeah, seriously. If it's to me, it's one or the other. But yeah, they will no longer be a thing. Both gunsmith materials and telemetries are just going to vanish from your inventory.
Bye-bye. Are you crying, Sin? Are you crying, Sin?
No, I got 14,000. Of the gunsmith materials, and I used some of them earlier just because I knew that I would have to, but I'm not really using them to go for any rolls. Like, it doesn't matter to me. Mm-hmm. Like, there was something that I lost the other time. It might have been the Crucible tokens or
Vanguard tokens, maybe whatever it was that we got rid of most recently that you had to use or lose. Like I had so many of those too that I didn't bother with. One, I didn't feel like going through the whole motion of burning them all. I could find better use of my time.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, I was hoping I'd hear a sob story, but I guess you're not caring.
No, I mean,
I've got 14,000 as well, and I'm just like, well, after the last one where I literally, like, this is one of the few times I will say Stadia is handy. Sat at work, logged in, and just cashed in all of those items. Like, I'm not doing that again with Gunsmith Materials when I'm not getting anything out of it other than rolls.
And a few spoiler alerts.
Yeah. Right?
But you could dismantle the rolls and get shards, right? I mean, not that I need shards, but...
I've got 22,000.
Right? Well, I'm just trying to put a spin on it. See what would be the reason to turn them in.
Now, for the people who haven't played in a while, it gives them a reason to play.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
You don't have to be such a negative Nancy about it. You can get stuff out of it. Grief.
You can.
God.
Right? Yeah, so, Des, why would you want to turn in your gunsmith materials?
Rolls. I mean, they pretty much already said it. It's all about rolls. I mean, legitimately. Right. But the good news, I mean, the nifty thing about the gunsmith is that he does have items that are harder to find within the world pool. So he's a little more focused than some drops. So if there's a weapon you like that's in the world pool, you can potentially get it easier through Banshee. At least that's how he works now. That's probably completely going to change in Witch Queen. because yes, he will function similarly to the rest of the reworks that they've done, and in order to gain reputation with Banshee, you just dismantle stuff and you get rep with Banshee, or you do bounties for Banshee to get rep for Banshee.
More fetch quests, yay.
Oh yeah, exactly.
I can give you an example, Des, real quick, of a weapon and a roll. And this kind of reminded me back when DSC, when, you know, Philo, maybe with an auto-loading holster, was pretty good. You can definitely roll Philos out of there if you don't have one of those, if you need that shotgun.
Yep.
That could be an option.
People got it that way, yeah. I may have even gotten it that way. And it didn't take me too long. So it's better than you might think. But yeah. I'm not going to turn in all materials, that's for sure.
But yeah, there's, like I said, there are things. I'm sure there's also ways to be able to, because it's been so long since I've looked at the world pool, I have no idea what's in it anymore. That's a whole nother convoluted mess. but yeah, I do like what they're doing with Banshee here, though, because again, it's pretty much the exact same that Banshee is functioning as now, but basically with the removal of tokens from pretty much everything else, they're getting rid of the middleman for Banshee. You don't have to turn in a material to gain the rep. You just do the thing you've already been doing and you just automatically gain the rep. So I'm a grand fan of that.
Yeah. That right there makes sense.
It will also be interesting to see exactly what Banshee will have, like, I guess in terms of loot pool or whatever, like, because, I mean, yes, his rep is changing, but is his drops potentially also changing? I mean, that's about to be quite a rare engram to get. Let's see. Mods and mod components. Guess what? Those are leaving too. Bye-bye.
Well, amateur bullshit.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, they're useless. I've got a few hundred of them, but
there's a word we use in the IT world, and that's called deprecated.
Right. Exactly.
awesome.
But yeah, so there will be, they are changing how you buy mods. Like armor and weapon mods from Ada and Banshee, because they usually require mod components to be able to pick up, and they will instead cost 10,000 glimmer each. No need for the wacky, silly, one-time use economy item. That's about all it is. And also, they are getting rid of the ghost mods, Arc Analyzer, Solar Analyzer, Void Analyzer, Omni Telemetry, and Banshee Special, because guess what? There's going to be no more telemetry, so those are dead. And let's all hail our new Daimyo Master Rahul.
Hail Rahul.
Right?
Rahul.
Right? Because he is taking over the spider's business. He is going to be handling all of the material exchanges, pretty much all of your material changes, because they are taking away the capability. Well, they're not just taking away Tangle Shore, but as they're mentioning here, they're also taking away Banshee's Enhancement Prism and Enhancement Shard trades. So that way, Banshee and Ada can actually offer more mods, which is great for those that don't have all the mods. More chances to get some of these rarer mods that a lot of people, you know, latch onto, like High Energy Fire, Powerful Friends, crap like that. So Rahul is even taking some of Banshee and Ada's business, as well as all of the spiders, because yes, Tangle Shore will be gone. He's just going to be a one-stop shop. Sadly, we were getting so close from completely phasing Rahul out, and now they do this.
Well, they gave him shaders, and they were like, well, no, that's not going to work.
Yeah. No.
Right? I mean, this is awful. And he's going to be...
Yes, this next part. I'm happy about this.
No, this is good news. He will be able to just straight out decrypt umbral engrams.
Go figure.
Right? He will not be able to focus them, but he can, like I said, he can just straight out decrypt them, which is great for like end of season.
He's an amateur then. I mean, what's wrong?
Oh, yeah. He's 100% amateur, but also
amateur
again,
bullshit.
He is our new daimyo, and he will be in charge of everything else. So have your tribute ready when Witch Queen drops. Just saying. Good news.
Hey, he's somewhat useful.
He is now, sadly. Good news. Hawkmoon and Deadman's Tale. Spicy items whose missions are leaving with Witch Queen. So do everything you can with those missions that you need to get done for various reasons. But the good news is, as far as the weapons go, Xur will be selling random rolled versions of Hawkmoon and DMT. Both?
It'll only cost you the mortgage on your house.
Right. I first read this and thought, oh, hey, this is great news. And then I read the cost, which is 1 Ascendant Shard, 1 Exotic Cipher, 125K of Glimmer, and 200 Legendary Shards. Now,
unless they're doubling the Glimmer cap, that's bullshit.
Yeah, that's a lot of glamour. Like we just said earlier, like glimmer ain't no thing right now. But you start paying 125K, and you start feeling it.
Well, and again, 125,000 arbitrary units is fine. But when I can only hold 250,000, that's if I can hold 500,000, that hurts less. That's a quarter of my right.
Yeah, 100%.
And then same thing, exotic ciphers. If they drop on even a reasonably,
to be fair, frequent basis. You can get one a week from Xur. To be fair, there.
Exotic cipher?
Well, he has a quest that can reward you with an exotic cipher, so you're going to have to jump through 15 million hoops, several of which are on fire. And then you can trade the quest in for an exotic cipher. But you can get one per week.
If you have the soul.
Exactly. Well, not really your soul, just your will to live.
Yes. And if that wasn't enough, also 200 legendary shards. Really? Like that?
Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. I get too many sitting around anyway.
Well, take away all I don't have a problem with it either, but after paying those first three things, that's like flicking me in the balls on the way out.
okay. Exactly. There you go. I like that. Exactly. Because, yeah, it's like paying for something that's like, okay, your credit card's maxed, your bank account's cleaned out. Oh, I'm going to take this dime, too. See ya.
Right.
Oh, that's brilliant.
So that's fair. Good news, though. Catalysts for Hawkmoon, DMT, and Aegir Scepter, even though these activities will be going, these catalysts will be dropping from playlist activities. Strikes, Crucible, Gambit.
One from each, or randomly one of three from any of them?
I believe basically these catalysts are going to drop from anywhere, everywhere, essentially. It's just going to be, yeah.
Because I'm not, if it was tied to each one, I'm not getting whatever the Gambit one is.
Yeah.
And it'll probably be DMT at that point.
I'm wanting to say that's how they did the Deathbringer catalyst. I can't think of anything else that they've made with the catalyst that's dropped recently, but I think Deathbringer worked that way. You just had to do something, playlist activity, and it would eventually drop. So there is that. Also, excellent news for those of us that have some of these things that never got the catalyst done. In the Anywhere Everywhere playlist activity completion catalyst whirlpool will be catalysts for Whisper the Worm, the Fourth Horseman, and Outbreak Perfected. Finally. So, yeah. And, of course,
Are these on a knockout list?
I mean, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, actually, these are, right?
I mean, yeah, because the only way you're going to get them to drop is if you don't have them, so... Okay. Technically, yes.
Well, no, I don't want to play in like, well, we would have dropped you another Outbreak Perfected, but you already had it, so you don't get anything else.
You get another catalyst drop. That would be wild. They haven't done that yet, so hopefully they won't do it now.
Then to add salt in the wounds, it resets your catalyst progress. Anyway.
And cost you 200.
On the way out, don't forget that. And,
on the way out,
and that's what we call a callback. But I and the good news, Outbreak Perfected and the Whisper of the Worm had their catalysts reconfigured to not necessitate their activities. Gee, I wonder why. So yeah, which could actually be incredibly bad news, like they did with the World Line Zero. Because I remember I had 3 out of 6 or 3 out of 8 or whatever completed on Worldline Zero, and then they modified the catalyst, and all of a sudden I had 3 out of 300 kills required to complete that catalyst. And I'm like, that's what? Rough.
They changed one of the requirements to not be, or because a thing went away.
Yeah. It was the
and they swapped it for 300 kills.
Yeah, and if you and the progress was not a relative to your former progress. So
did you have 200 legendary shards?
I'd rather they would have taken the legendary shards. Good God! And to this day, my Worldline Zero is still not mastered. That's a grudge right there.
No, definitely. And it's not like you really need it at this point.
Right. Because after all, we have so many better legendary swords. So right. Screw you, Worldline Zero. But that's Twoppy Twop Top. Hang on. I feel like I'm
autistic. We do just have to talk about the raid blues.
Day. Yeah. I don't know. I feel like there should be more here.
Well, they have a little there is, and also.
Yeah, no, I'm getting there. But I'm making a point here. This is lackluster.
But right? There's a lot of words.
I mean, there are a bunch of worms. Like,
I can sum it up for you if you'd like. Shit's broken.
Oh, I gotta love that about the communication of Bungie. Anyhow, raid date. We have it. Kind of surprising, actually. I was expecting this a little closer to release. But yeah, March 5th, the Witch Queen Redacted raid will be dropping 10 a.m. Pacific.
2 weeks? That's about right.
Yeah, that's actually kind of generous, because it's normally, I think, well, at least because DSC, I think, was 2 weeks as well. But before that, it's usually like a week if you're lucky.
Well, we do have to raise, what, 200 power level to get to even a sniff at it?
Yeah. Well, it's, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's It'll probably be 10 days. So it's the Saturday after Tuesday, you get one Saturday, and it's the next Saturday. So I guess it's kind of a week and a few days. What were they going to do? Put it on the 26th? Stuff.
And then, but yeah, as far as power level, I seem to think I remember how they did this was they would have the opening encounter be 10 above the pinnacle cap, I think. So, if we're looking at, what was it, 1560? Is that what we were looking at for the hard cap? Sorry, I'm not using the right word.
1550 for hard cap.
Yeah.
Which meant hard and soft.
Well, it didn't matter anyway. Once you get to a certain point, it's contest mode regardless.
Right.
That's true. Yeah. So, in other words, to be determined.
To be determined.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You just know the date.
Yes. I wouldn't say it's too soon at all. I think that's about where they put it, 10 days.
Yeah. That's.
I think you forgot that February only has the 28 days, so it felt like it was longer.
But no, like I said, I'm completely down. 10 days, that's great. I just remember, remember the days when it hasn't been 10 days. You have 5 days.
Or day one, right?
So yes, that's that. And then of course we had a hot fix as of the date of recording. Known issues. This was actually interesting, and people have when first spawning into an area or activity, hand cannons sometimes don't have ammo.
Good.
That's great. That's great. Right. Just pistol whip them. You're fine.
You have ammo in your other guns. You shoot one person, you're going to get ammo. We're fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
Something about...
I love that it was just hand cannons, because I hate hand cannons. could that first spawning be Crucible? Please.
Right.
I would love to see the first trials and everyone with their last words going, crap.
Dang it. Let's see. I feel like I've missed something because all of a sudden there's the story about the editor and being saved from his apartment that's in quotations. This feels really weird. But anyway, beyond that, which... Oof. But yes, here we go. Quick clarification before we go.
Oh, yeah, the bounties not being removed at the end of the season.
That was the patch notes. Because, yes, hotfix 3.0. Yeah, hang on. the patch notes. Because I love these patch notes, right? Whoever's in charge of these patch notes, I love these people. Because they've had so many instances of this. One thing that got fixed in this patch, the colorblind stuff I heard is fixed and is fantastic again. But no, they fixed an issue where Hunter class ability cooldown times would increase if the player's mobility stat were over 100, meaning you would have a slower cooldown for having over 100 mobility. Of course, why would you have
second hunters?
Right? I mean, essentially, even
if you lean too hard, you fall down sometimes.
As the patch notes say, players may now increase their mobility to whatever value over 100 that they desire without detriment to their cooldown timers, even if it provides no real benefit. Seriously, go ahead. Max that stat out. We dare you. Show us how high you can get your mobility. That's asking for it right there. Right. We're going to see people like 300 mobility. Jesus. All right. But anyway, I wanted to get that out of the way because I... Like I said, whoever writes the patch notes, I love that person. Let's see. Yes, clarification about Iron Banner bounties, or bounties in general, things and stuff. Iron Banner bounties will not be removed at the end of the season. Bounties acquired and completed at any point during the season will be retained after the Witch Queen releases. Bounties retained from Season Lost will be capped at 1350 power and will not give players any power bonus next season upon redemption. Additional note, these bounties will be removed at the end of Season 16, as Saladin will be taking his turn in our rollout of vendor reworks. Final note. Final Iron Banner of the season will be the last week of the season.
Convenient.
Right.
Yeah.
Seasonal bounties related to Season of the Hunt, Season of the Chosen, Season of the Splicer, Season of the Lost will be removed at the end of the season.
Because that whole area is going away, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, those activities, so yeah.
Hence yeah.
Yeah.
Bounties from the Tangle Shore destination will be removed at the end of the season. Some daily bounties from
blowing up
general activities or destinations may be removed depending on the objective or reward balancing on a per bounty basics. Example, a handful of Drifter and Gunsmith bounties are being looked at alongside some vendor work. Now you see, whoever did this, I'm not a huge fan of this person. And if it's the same person that did the patch notes, I'm suddenly very disappointed. Because this is very ham-fisted and it's like, note, oh dear, did we just confirm the Drifter is getting a pass? Who cares? Come on, don't be sassy about something that you're giving away for free. Come on. But yes, they will be tinkering with Gambit in Season 16, which they've said before. They've said about making passes about Gambit soon-ish.
They give away the secret by saying this shouldn't be a surprise.
Right.
I feel like if a lot more people paid attention to the TWAB, a lot of these jokes would not even be thought of. Right, Hazel?
Amateur bullshit.
Thanks, Hazel.
Yeah, so next week's TWAB is going to be hippie again. Yay.
Cool.
TWAB.
Four cats? Four more cats?
I don't know.
Yeah, she gave us three last time. Well, two and then a double up on the last one.
Yeah.
So, yeah, that's it's words.
That's
I actually missed the cats this time. I got to go back and look at them.
It's DMG, so there's no cats.
Sin.
Oh, no cats.
That's why you missed them.
DMG doesn't like fun.
No. No fun.
But seriously, yeah, TWAB. It was words. Not particularly great words, but words.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah. Okay. Blues. Great.
I mean, yeah.
Less of them and more purples. Something's got to drop, right? So it's going to be more purples.
Over the next, said way back at the beginning, but circling back around, over the next few TWABs, they will be talking about Vanguard rep, Gambit reworks. See, they even said it right there at the start of this TWAB. Why are they being sneaky? Anywho, weapon crafting and Void 3.0, but not necessarily in that order. And if it's going to be in that order, I might scream.
let's get the Void 3.0 to us.
I have a feeling I'm going to, unless they do Void 3.0, I'm going to scream because I don't want to have to earn stuff that I've already earned already.
No, I don't doubt they'll do that, right? Bungie's not that cruel, right?
Yeah. Right? Yeah, they are.
Right? No. It's Bungie we're talking about.
That's going to frustrate me. But no, I'll give it. I'll once they start speaking, I'll save my bile for that when they actually say what they're going to tinker with.
Fair. Yeah, I don't know. I'm definitely super stoked to hear about weapon crafting and Void 3.0, 100%.
Sure. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Need that. Need them words.
Well, so, will that make up for the lack of blues? Will that make up for purples just constantly dropping from everywhere?
Oh, yeah, that is a part I missed. Thank you for saying that, because, with no blues, you actually get a slightly increased chance at purples.
Mm-hmm. So,
yeah. Yay.
Yeah, sure. That just makes sense. Like, I can go through right now and clean my vault just by getting rid of blues, because it's fodder. But what I can't tell is how many of these purples are fodder as well.
Yeah.
And when everything is special, nothing is special.
Hmm.
I'm done with... What is this? I have... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I've got 15 Sorrows Verses. Why? Because they just keep throwing at me, and they're all 1320. And one of those might be a good roll. Probably none of them. So, I
think there's very few weapons that I have multiples of. Like, I don't have a particular need of keeping that many.
I don't try for them. They just drop, right? Like, I turn in gunsmith bounty, gunsmith materials, and I get the same six weapons over and over and over and over and over again, and it's mostly the same rolls because the loot pool on it, or whatever the RNG is for the prime perks, is, I don't know, is it weighted? Do we know?
No.
Like, or is it strictly straight up, roll the dice, we have 100 perks that we can put in this column, you get one of them?
I mean, as far as we know, there's no waiting to particular perks. But that's, again, as far as we know.
Yeah, I don't know. I personally, bring back greens. I liked them. They were good fodder just to get level up and to infuse into other things. And once you hit a certain point, then give me some blues. Then give me purples that I want to actually go for.
I agree with you bringing back greens real quick, but not in the capacity that they were. I think if they bring them back, they should make them set pieces. And then you have a even more rare item to get as far as a set. And it makes sets meaningful. And, you know, they have sets in other MMOs, right? I mean, that's typically an MMO thing. You have a set of gear and it gives you additional perks by completing the set or having so many pieces of the set. That would be the capacity that I would want them to bring a green back in.
I thought sets are usually like more on the higher level, like the exotic or the legendary level.
Yeah, I mean,
for MMOs, no.
Okay.
Well, in Diablo, yes. They're more exotic than
in Diablo. Wait, you're going to mention MMOs and then you're going to bring up Diablo? Sir, do you not know who you're talking to right now?
Hey.
No, but
I'm using that as a basis of rarity.
Well, you can stop because Diablo is a looter. It's not even a persistent world.
No, it's Destiny.
Different.
The system that we powered up for, what was it? What was the Olympics? What was that freaking event called again?
Guardian Games. Right.
There you go. But the system that we leveled up that loot, I loved that. Like, that made sense to me. Yeah. I had started out with greens. I ticked off all the boxes. Oh, no. They became blues.
Yeah, you're talking about Solstice.
Solstice, yeah. And then those blues became purples. And then those purples became something by working those. Like, bring that kind of a system back. Bring that back with my guns, right?
I don't like it for guns.
I get 1,000 kills, give me, turn it blue, give it an extra perk slot. When I get 10,000 kills on that, turn it purple and give me an extra perk slot. You know, give me stuff like that. But I don't like, again, I got too many guns that have similar roles that are all no good. I'm hanging on to them because they may rework Adrenaline Junkie next season, and all of those ones that I just sharded are now the golden goose.
Don't shard on the golden goose. But no, I hear what you're saying. Actually, I could even see that for guns somewhat, as long as they're usable, and then that, yeah, it's just opening that extra slot. You know, you don't want to have them like in a weird state at first. Too basic.
Yeah, which is also the exact progression of Necrochasm back in the day.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, I remember that.
So if that's what they want to do with gun crafting, you want to earn a multi-kill clip, go out and get multi-kills with it. You want to earn a range masterwork or a range perk on it, go use it at range. Struggle with it at range. You know?
But that's too nice. You think they're... Hopefully they'll do that.
It would make more sense than what they're doing now. And that would actually be crafting. I cut down trees, guess what I get? Wood. Right?
Whew,
yes, all right. Yes. You get if you shard on the goose.
Yeah. I sharded on the goose and I got wood. Clip it. But I don't whack myself, right? I don't whack a rock for 10 minutes to get straw, right? Like,
going with this.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure what you're going with.
Yeah. God damn.
Awesome.
Now.
Oh, man. Well, hey, I'm glad we could have these more, well, not necessarily hot takes, but from I guess, our, no, quote, boring twab, and now we have better ideas, yeah. Bungie. Bring them to us.
Yeah, legitimately. Like, that's one reason I'm actually super stoked to hear about weaponcraft. I want to hear something solid from weaponcrafting.
Right.
Because if they dare call it weaponcrafting, like I said, it needs some semblance of a good progression system. It needs it.
Right.
Otherwise, it's just another arbitrary destiny system.
Mm-hmm.
And that would just be far less interesting.
Mm. Well, that's the sure. TWAB.
Hey, that's the TWAB.
TWAB!
Do you like update, Kingsley?
Yeah.
443 out of 500 for the Ether Harvest now.
Nice. What did you start at?
Yesterday was like 315.
Okay.
But it doesn't count completions, we found out. And we did test this. Anybody who's looking to get this Triumph, it counts the little purple balls that you shoot. So it's good if you're there by yourself, because you can get around 30 of them if you can knock them all out. So you can really knock out that Triumph pretty quicker than you might think. Because originally, and I think, Kingsley, you and I were discussing yesterday, I think you had a conversation with Helios about the amount of completions.
Yeah.
And it's not 500 completions. It is now counting, it is counting the little purple orbs that you can shoot that spit out. So...
So you heard it here. If you see Cyn in the Tangled Shore, join him so you can steal his kills.
I swear to God.
Joining Cyn now.
Well, I'm in the Lord of Nothing strike. I'm trying to go for scorn kills.
Oh God, that thing too. The pike thing?
Yeah, I've gotten a couple, but now this one I loaded into was already in progress. And they're already to the point where the pikes are at. So I'm probably not going to get any. But I've gotten like 20 of them tonight, just putzing around.
Fantastic.
Well, other than like the weapon crafting thing, Nate, any other hot takes that you have for the game of Destiny? Like, if you could have your way, what would you want them to do?
Other than the bring back greens thing and completely retool Gambit, which sounds like I might be getting my wish on that one. And we'll avoid the low-hanging fruit of more vault space.
But that's not happening.
I would love to see clan allies allied clans come back.
Oh.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of stuff you can do in this game that requires... not requires, but benefits from having a clan or clan allies that... we work around because we're in Discord communities and we're in other, you know, other methods of reaching out to each other. But to people that don't do that, my 6-person clan, their 12-person clan, this other person's 8-person clan, right? It's a start somewhere without having to go, well, I have to fold my clan and hopefully the new clan leader doesn't kick me out. Right?
Yeah, no doubt.
And you can network a little bit better in this game. So yeah, I would love to see the clan alliances come back, and my God, do they need to rework guided games? So those would be my two wishes. Like make guided games functional, for God's sake. And then yeah, clan allies. Make those two things happen. Make old Nate happy.
Yeah. I love it. Okay, those weren't too hot a takes. All right. More drama before we end the show.
Sure. is this where we do the speed run?
You win. You're a winner of the year, okay? We'll just say that Sweet. For now. Unless someone else brings up speed run, and then we'll have a tie.
Oh, crap. It'll cost them 200 legendary shards.
Yeah. We don't need the GDC lawyers on us. Yeah. It would make us look bad after we had our TGH lawyers on them.
Oh, my gosh.
All right. What else? Anything else? Or we can start moving to drinks, desserts, things like that.
Cool. Yeah, I'm ready to move on.
I'm ready for it.
All right. Because I kind of want to ask you a bonus question. Most people just get asked, what's your favorite dessert? I want to know that, but I also want to know, because you kind of had this discussion too, right, about different kinds of whiskey. But tell us something, you know, just a good whiskey, a good drink you like, and a good dessert.
Ooh, my favorite dessert, when I can find it, is buttermilk pie.
What is that?
It's a pie. Des,
do you know about buttermilk pie?
It sounds familiar, but I can't like.
It's a very Cajun thing. It's got the consistency of a cheesecake, maybe even so much as like a quiche. It's just buttery, sweet, and rich, and yeah. If you can find a recipe for one, have someone make you one. It is hands down like my favorite, my absolute favorite dessert. And I'm lucky enough to have a little Cajun hole in the wall place where they make it from mom's recipe from scratch.
Oh,
and it's $12 a slice and worth every penny.
Okay.
Nice.
And then as far as whiskeys are concerned, if you want to be baller on a budget, get yourself some Suntory. The Japanese whiskeys are delightful and not overly expensive. Good smooth finish on them.
I do want to try that. I don't know if our store has it. Are they harder to find or not too hard to find?
They're not hard to find at all. They were okay for a hot minute because there was because they became so popular so fast, we burned through the stock that they couldn't keep up capacity. So now that the years have gone by and they are now bottling at that capacity, it's no longer an issue. Like there was a while, a bottle of Suntory was costing, you know, $80-$90. Now it's $26. Okay. Hibiki is another one that's a really good one. And same thing, it can be had for like $34. And it's like for $26, I'm used to getting Johnny Walker Red, and you know how that is. Like that's turpentine. Mm. So yeah, to have something that's got some quality for that kind of for that price point, you can't beat it. And then if I want to go higher end, give me an Oban or a Lafroig.
Sounds fancy.
Oban's not actually that bad. Oban, you can get 18 for probably in the $80 range, and it's really good. And then Lafroig, if you like your really peaty smoky scotches, that's a front runner there.
Nice.
Yep.
But yeah, like I'll take on all comers. I love a good bourbon. Like I usually have a bottle of Bullet Rye in the house. Yeah, I'll keep a bottle of Johnny Walker Black as house whiskey. Another one that's a good house whiskey is Monkey Shoulder. And then, yeah, I've got a full wine fridge full of wine. Red's preferred, but, you know.
Mr. Pinky up in the air.
No, Mr. Pinky up in the air, yes. Yeah, that bottle of 19 Crimes Cali Red with Snoop Dogg's face on it is not Pinky in the air. You've seen that bottle, haven't
awesome.
You?
That's yeah. awesome stuff right there. awesome. They have Toki Suntory IC on the state liquor website. You can check stock. So
yes.
I might have to pick that up tomorrow.
Yes, Suntory Toki is, that's your basic, like that is your entry level into Japanese whiskeys.
Thank you for that information.
Mm-hmm.
And seriously, I am going to look up this buttermilk pie. That is so wild. Never heard of that.
I happened to come across that one because the girl I was dating before my wife, reason I was in Pensacola, grew up in that area and grew up around some good Cajun cuisine. And when she came out here to LA, was like, I need some back home food. And we found this little hole in the wall called Les Sisters, and you know, had the B rating on the door, like that's. That kind of hole in the wall. No brooches or anything, but yeah, you know, it's a greasy spoon. And like the Cajun food was on point. And when we were done, like I was everything, like just gobbling it up. And the guy comes out and he goes, "You want to try the buttermilk pie?" I'm like, "Buttermilk pie." And she looks like her eyes wide and she goes, "You have that?" I said, "Oh, fuck it. Let's get a slice." So two slices, $24. I went, "Are you kidding me?" And it she goes, "Well, let's try it. It's got to be good." And yeah, I was sold from that moment on.
I mean, you've sold me, so I just gotta find this now.
Yeah, you're gonna find a recipe. You're gonna take a bite, and you're gonna go, "What the?" And then you're gonna spit out your Suntory Toki, and you're gonna be like, "We're never having this guy on our podcast ever again. He was so wrong."
No, I do not. I'm sure it's gonna be.
And you're
awesome,
gonna go, so. "This is what you get for not liking Gambit. Give me 200 legendary shards."
Right.
Oh, man. Excellent. All right. Boy, you're in the Discords. Do you have any other way that people follow you? Do you do Twitter at all? Anything else? If now's the
time
to let us know.
I do Twitter. It's GG, N8FOO, like the handle here, N8FOO. I do have a Twitch channel that I'm very rarely on, but you might actually see me in the wee hours of the morning when I switch over to this graveyard shift, because, you know, I'm going to need to stay awake on the weekends.
Yeah.
So yeah, you might see me a little more there. I'm very rarely on, again, life prohibiting. And then because I'm a West Coast guy, by the time I get on at 9 o'clock at night, y'all asleep. So I'm playing games to myself and watching what I say, because I don't want to piss off the overlords that run the site. So it's like, turn it off. I can have fun. Me and the wife can banter back and forth and bitch about the kids.
Yeah.
So.
Oh, awesome talking to you. And if I get out to Southern California, I'll have to definitely see if I can meet up at some point.
Definitely. We'll do some roller coasters and drink some booze.
Definitely. All right. Let's go, Dez. Where can people find you, good sir?
Well, you can find me, of course, right, in the Discord, lurking about. Find me at DES_Raven on Twitter, which is the home of the Vestas Index. Which, yeah. It's a thing. Go check it out, everyone.
Right? Not the Bird Rock? Not the Bird Rock.
No, that was one. That was one. Bird Rock, Featherstone, it's had... You can blame Burning for some of those names. He used to be... used to be my namer for this spreadsheet, so or at least suggester for names. So yeah, so a lot of those you can blame him for. Yeah,
we see how suggesting names works in these communities, right?
Yes, Cyn.
Well, shoot, you can find me
cleaning up some triumphs between now and Witch Queen, or over on Twitter at Cyn_media. Kingsley Suntory Toki Mac, take us out.
I love the little closeout, Cyn. Thank you very much. You can find me as Kingsley Mac all the places, except for on Twitter, where I am MC Kingsley.
McKingsley.
And you can find our show either on Twitter at The Guardian Hub or on our lovely website with all our links and information, theguardianhub.com.
The best hub on the net.
Thank you, Cyn. Thank you, Des. And very special thanks to our guest, Mr. 8FOO.
Yes, thank you, sir.
It's been my pleasure, fellas.
And business doing pleasure.
Business doing pleasure. And thanks, everyone, for listening again this week. We'll talk to you again next week. Have a good one.
All right.
Bye. Flip
me in the balls on the way out.
Two blues and a token is now 200 shards and a flick.